Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021, our last meeting before recess. This morning we will take evidence on the latest ministerial statement and subordinate legislation. I'd like to welcome to the meeting John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, Amanda Gordon, Deputy Director of Local Interventions Outbreak Management, and Derek Greaves, Head of Operational Vaccine Division. Thank you for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move on to questions?
Thank you, Kavir, and good morning. I'm grateful to the committee for the opportunity to discuss a number of matters, including updates to Parliament on COVID-19. As set out by the First Minister on Tuesday, Omicron continues to spread rapidly across the country. We are now seeing the impacts of rising cases and staff absences across the economy. We do not yet know conclusively if the proportion of Omicron cases needing hospital care is lower, higher, or the same as with Delta, although there are early signs from the analysis undertaken by the University of Edinburgh that lower levels of hospitalisation may be likely. However, even if the proportion of cases needing hospital care is lower, a smaller proportion of a much larger number of infections will place a significant burden on the National Health Service. It is therefore critical that we continue to respond both effectively and proportionately to mitigate the impacts of Omicron. Our vaccination programme is central to our response, and there has been a significant acceleration of the programme in the past week. I encourage everyone to book their booster appointment as soon as possible. In addition to vaccination, other protective measures will help us reduce the impact of Omicron on our society and economy in the immediate term, and these measures are necessary to be undertaken. We should all now be reducing our contacts with people in other households. If people are gathering with loved ones this weekend to celebrate Christmas, it is essential that we do all that we can to be as safe as possible. This includes keeping gatherings as small as family circumstances allow, ensuring everyone takes a test before meeting, maintaining good hygiene, and ventilating indoor spaces. The First Minister set out on Tuesday that after this weekend, we should all stay at home as much as possible and continue to limit our contacts. This includes minimising socialising over Hogmanay and New Year. Staying at home and minimising contact outside our own households is critical in the period ahead. If we all follow this advice, we will help to limit the spread of infection. In addition, the Scottish Government is introducing further proportionate protections, primarily affecting public events and hospitality. These are necessary to help stem the increase in cases, safeguard health and protect the National Health Service, the emergency services and the economy, while we complete and get the full effect of the booster programme. First, from the 26th of December inclusive for a period of 3 weeks, we intend to place limits on the size of public events that can take place. This does not apply to private life events such as weddings. This will of course make sports matches, including football, effectively spectator-free over this three-week period. It will also mean that large-scale Hogmanay celebrations will not proceed. This will reduce the risk of widespread transmission and impact on emergency services attending these events. Second, during the same period, non-professional indoor contact sports for adults should not take place, and guidance will reflect this. Finally, from 27th of December inclusive for a period of 3 weeks, we intend to introduce some further protections in hospitality settings and other indoor places to reduce transmission risks. This includes table service in venues serving alcohol for consumption on these premises and 1 metre distancing between groups. Convener, I want to highlight one further change to our proposals on this point that were announced on Tuesday. Having engaged with the sector, we now propose to require that nightclubs should not operate as such for this three-week period. While it would be open to them to operate with distancing and table service, and that option will remain, we consider that closure in regulations, combined with financial support, may reduce losses and help these businesses weather what we hope will be a short period until they are able to operate normally again. This change will be affected by a separate Scottish statutory instrument coming into force at the same time, which my officials have already shared with the committee this morning. The Scottish Government is acutely aware of the financial implications for many businesses. The First Minister detailed additional support totalling £375 million that will be made available, including £100 million announced last week to support businesses directly impacted by Omicron. An update will be provided on the breakdown and allocation of funding as soon as possible. Eligibility and guidance for the £66 million Hospitality Fund was published on the Scottish Government website on Tuesday. We expect further guidance for the remaining funds to be published shortly. And I look forward to answering questions the committee may have this morning.
Thank you very much, Deputy First Minister, for the update. If I move to questions, and if I could start, in the last week, there's been a 67.1% increase in the number of lateral flow tests which have been distributed, which is positive, as I think the general public are being cautionary with the new variant. But I'm slightly confused with the daily figures that are being published, because I was expecting them to be doubling every day. And I think they peaked earlier in the week just under 6,000. Then yesterday we had they dropped to 2,434 positive cases. Is there an understanding why the figures being reported are not as we predicted at this stage?
There's a particular, I think the sequence of data, convener, over the course of the last 2 to 3 weeks has essentially substantiated the rapid acceleration of cases driven by the Omicron variant. The data yesterday, there are problems with the data yesterday, which was a consequence of a data processing issue that Public Health Scotland is aware of and is handling. I haven't seen the data for today, but I would expect the data for today to essentially take account of the fact that the numbers yesterday understated the number of positive cases that were in the system. I think if you look at the sequence of data, there is generally there's not a precise relationship between the number of positive cases and the positivity proportion that is reported on a daily basis. It's not precise, because in the positive cases, Public Health Scotland extract the people who have previously tested positive. So it's the positive cases a number is essentially new positive cases. So if somebody has already tested positive, that will be extracted from the system. So the relationship between new cases and the positivity rate is not precise, but it's pretty close. If you look at the data yesterday, those two numbers have no relationship. So there was a problem with the data processing yesterday. I think that will be rectified today and probably tomorrow, and we will see the pattern of significant growth being reflected in that data. I'm not sure, perhaps my officials want to add anything to what I've said.
I think Professor Leitch has asked to come in. Would you like to come in, Professor Leitch?
Thanks. Good morning, convener. Morning, everybody. The Deputy First Minister is absolutely right. Today's figures will correct yesterday's number and give a new number for today that will look more like you would expect. The lesson here is don't look at individual days, look at patterns. And if you look at the seven-day rate, it is accelerating significantly. The other thing to remind you of is that, remember, Delta is falling as Omicron rises. So what's doubling is the Omicron element of the total, not the total. Once Omicron becomes the only variant, the whole number will double at the Omicron rate. But just now we have remnants of a Delta wave, a significant remnant of the Delta wave, which could be as many as 2,000-3,000 cases a day. That number, if you remember a few weeks ago, was diminishing. It's not doubling. In fact, it's falling. The Omicron number inside that 6,000 is doubling at 3 days. So that's why it's quite awkward to look at a single day's data and make a judgment. You have to do it over a prolonged period. And Mr. Swinney is absolutely right. Yesterday there was a technical IT problem that only affected the reporting to us. It didn't affect the reporting to the individuals who require the positive test news. It didn't affect Test and Protect. All of that worked. It was just the final number that came to us was lower than it should have been, and that will be corrected at 2 o'clock today.
Thank you very much, Professor Leach. I think we all understand the importance of boosters, but we still have nearly 10% of the population unvaccinated, especially in our larger cities. A constituent of mine wrote to me recently after watching our vaccine hesitancy committee, which took place on the 9th of December. And I'd like to read what she wrote to me. This is from Angela in Ayr, and she's around the same age as myself. Hi Siobhan, I just wanted to get in touch to let you know that I've just got out of hospital after contracting life-threatening COVID-19. I was hospitalised for 9 weeks. I was blue-lighted from air to cross house and was in high dependency unit and ICU with my oxygen levels at 38%. I'd been unwell for 4 or 5 days prior and was advised just to self-isolate and drink plenty of water and take paracetamol. Unfortunately, things progressed. I don't remember much apart from seeing my fiancé and doctor and then being in an ambulance. Unfortunately, I had not been vaccinated, not because I was against it or anything. I had just landed a new job and missed my appointment as I had to go down south to be trained. I sat and I watched patients come and go from the hospital bed in high dependency. They were a lot older than me, people in their 70s with COPD and COVID, but they had had their vaccinations. And yes, they may have been poorly and still required oxygen, but they were going home after 2 weeks. And I watched this happen week after week, and I felt like an idiot for not getting myself vaccinated. I nearly died. I was touch and go a few times. Do not think this isn't real. It's very real. It doesn't look as though it's going away anytime soon. I've been left with fibrosis, a cluster of clots in my lung. I have panic attacks, palpitations. My anxiety is through the roof. I have COVID flashes. I've lost 3 stone in 5 weeks, and I've lost most of the muscle mass in my legs, and I can't walk from the kitchen to the living room. I can't stand for a length of time to go upstairs, and I literally am having to train myself to walk again. I could go on, but I won't. I just don't want this happening to anyone else. If anyone is hesitant about getting vaccinated, then don't. However rotten you feel after your jag is nothing compared to losing your life. How can we get this powerful message out to the general public about the importance of getting vaccinated, especially to the 10% that still haven't gone for their first jab?
Well, I think, Convener, the steps that you've taken today helps enormously in that respect. And I think the circumstances that Angela recounts, and I do hope that Angela is regaining her strength, although it is very obvious that she has suffered severe health impacts as a consequence of contracting COVID. I think it is important that these real-life examples are shared widely with the public, and in our communication we use a mixture of the strength of clinical opinion, which is we deploy in our communication, the Chief Medical Officer, Professor Leach, National Clinical Director, and other clinicians very strongly articulate the issues and the rationale of why individuals should seek vaccination. But there is a place for the testimony of individuals who have had the experience, the absolutely horrendous experience that you have recounted on behalf of your constituent, Convener. And I think it's important that those messages are shared. I think what's very clear is that the issues of logistics in accessing the vaccination programme have been well thought through, because the vaccination programme has been an enormous undertaking, and it has delivered very significant results. And it's been because the vaccination, one of the reasons is that the vaccination programme has been delivered within local communities, maximising local access. But we must constantly, and Derek Grieve and his team are doing this, constantly revisit the practicalities and the logistics of making it possible and plausible for people to access the programme. I think lastly I would say, at the heart of the point of the example you recited there, Angela was unable to take up her appointment because another commitment to her work intervened. What I would say is that there should be no individual in the country that feels they will get anything other than a warm welcome from a vaccination centre they turn up to get even a first dose at this stage. And there are people turning up and getting first doses as we speak. So we are constantly eroding that number of people who have not yet had started off on the vaccination journey. But I do hope that the example you've cited helps in that respect.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I'll move on to questions from other members now. And can I bring Ian Murdo-Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and to colleagues. Can I just, a couple of different issues I'd like to touch on this morning. Can I start by picking up, Cabinet Secretary, what you said in your introduction about the latest study that's just come out from Edinburgh and Strathclyde universities on the impact of Omicron? And there's also a lot of media coverage around a similar study from Imperial College London that comes to much the same conclusions, which is that Omicron seems to deliver a much lower level of hospitalizations than Delta. Now, I appreciate this is all based on very limited data in a short space of time, but nevertheless, is very encouraging news. On the other hand, there must be a risk that members of the public, seeing these headlines, start to relax and let down their guard, which could end up with more serious consequences. So I'm interested in getting your view on that, and specifically understanding how these new studies that are emerging will feed into decision making in the course of the coming week about any new restrictions that might be brought in post the Christmas period.
I think this is a very important question, and we have to proceed in the consideration of these issues with enormous care. I listened last night to Professor Aziz Sheikh, who is one of the principal author of the University of Edinburgh study, and I listened again to Professor Sheikh on the radio this morning. And of course, Mr. Fraser is absolutely correct that the study indicates that at this early stage, it appears that Omicron may result in a lower proportion of hospitalisation. Professor Sheikh was at length to press the point that, which is a point which ministers have made and other clinicians have made, that even if there is a lower proportion of hospitalisation, if that lower level of hospitalisation is of a much larger number of cases, which is apparent with Omicron, because the variant is spreading like wildfire through the country, then that will pose serious pressures on the National Health Service. So Professor Sheikh, in his, when he was asked, well, what should we, in the light of this study, what steps should we take? He essentially said, we should roll out the booster vaccination programme, and we should be limiting our social interaction. And that's precisely what the Scottish Government is doing. We are rolling out the vaccination booster programme, and we are encouraging people, in some cases requiring people, to reduce their social interaction. And that appears to me to be the proportionate and prudential approach to take at this stage. In relation to the last part of Mr. Fraser's question, how should this affect decision making in due course? Obviously, the government will look with care at studies of this type and will consider how this affects the judgment, which, as I've rehearsed with this committee on a number of occasions before, what are the proportionate steps we should take to deal with the significance of Omicron? Because the dilemma that ministers face is that if, for example, we do not take early enough action to suppress the circulation of the virus within our society, we will find that we have a problem that is too big to arrest, and it will be all too late, and our health service will be overwhelmed. The ministers in the Scottish Government have constantly taken the attitude and the view that we need to intervene early to try to take preventative action to avoid a situation running away from us. And obviously, we need to make a careful judgment about how long the restrictions that we have set out to come into effect on the 26th and the 27th of December need to be in place for, to ensure that we are taking sufficient action to suppress severity of the virus. And lastly, ministers always are cognizant of the fact that we have got to take proportionate decisions in relation to the state of the pandemic, and this study will be one factor that is added into that judgment.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Schwinney. It's a very, very comprehensive answer, and I'm sure there will be other colleagues on the committee who want to pursue some of these issues. But in view of the time available, I'm keen to ask you a question about another matter, which is the issue of business support. And we've seen an announcement this week from the Scottish Government specifically around support for the hospitality sector, which I know will be welcome to businesses there who've been hard hit by the cancellations. But can I just seek clarity on the other business sectors that you are currently proposing to and when we will hear more about what is available for them?
There is, of course, a wider question around business support. The global total that we have available is £375 million, £200 million of which has come from the Scottish Government funds, £175 million from the United Kingdom Government. Some initial allocations have been made in relation to hospitality that the Finance Secretary has approved. The Finance Secretary is currently considering these questions, and early announcements will be made as soon as is possible. Obviously, there's a great deal of dialogue going on with individual sectors to ensure that those judgments are the best informed they can be. So that dialogue is underway at the present moment, and decisions will be announced at the earliest opportunity. I can't be specific about that timescale at this stage, but the Finance Secretary will update Parliament accordingly.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Schmidt. I mean, maybe just one follow-up on that point. I've certainly been approached by a number of accommodation providers, people running guest houses and bed and breakfasts that don't qualify for support under the heading of hospitality, but have nevertheless seen a major impact on their business with cancellations. People who were coming to attend various events, concerts, football matches, people who were coming to Hogmanay events, they've all now been cancelled. People therefore are cancelling their trips, and that's a sector that's therefore seen a major hit. Are you looking at support for accommodation providers? Is that part of the mix in terms of sectors that might be eligible for assistance?
The Finance Secretary is engaging in dialogue with various sectors around this question, and as I said in my previous answer, she will make an announcement in due course. I think what I have to say is really a candid reflection that we are not going to be able to support everybody that's affected by the restrictions that are having to be put in place. We have made significant steps within our own resources to ensure that we're able to put some funding in place. The government has been explicit that it would help us enormously if there was a targeted extension of the furlough scheme from the United Kingdom government because of the challenges that we face. That's not been forthcoming so far, although I welcome the funding support that has come from the United Kingdom government. But I think we would be in a better position to be able to respond had we had access to a broader range of options, some of which would have included furlough. And if that had been available, then obviously the resources that we have at our disposal or from our resources could be deployed to tackle other challenges and other priorities. But as I say, the Finance Secretary will make announcements on this in due course.
Okay, and just one final question, Convener, just for clarity again on this point. You know, I, along with many others, I'm sure, have businesses contacting me every day seeking clarity. Can you give us any indication when we might get confirmation of this from the Finance Secretary?
These issues have been actively considered just now, and the Finance Secretary will update Parliament and the wider public at the earliest possible opportunity.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I please bring in Alex Rowley?
Convener, could I begin by asking Deputy First Minister, where the government's thinking's at in terms of self-isolation. I note that England have introduced a shorter period of self-isolation and, I think, two lateral flow tests.
This is an issue that has got treated with significant care, because the at the core of the challenge that we face in relation to the whole of COVID, but especially because of Omicron, is that we have a necessity to break the chains of transmission. That is critical. And it's nothing new. That's been the consistent challenge throughout COVID, and self-isolation is a critical element in that process. It is especially critical in relation to Omicron, because of the degree to which the transmissibility of Omicron, and that therefore puts an added emphasis on making sure that our self-isolation arrangements are appropriate. It obviously follows from that that if we don't apply the right self-isolation approach, then we run the risk of enabling people to be released from self-isolation who potentially may still be able to transmit the virus, and that defeats the purpose of self-isolation. So there's a fine judgment got to be applied on this question. Now, obviously, there is a lot of anxiety within the business community, for example, about the availability of key workers. And we do have, within the arrangements that we have in place, the exemptions for critical workers, and that process is managed very efficiently and very carefully within government to make sure that where it can be justified, individuals can be released from self-isolation to make a contribution to the delivery of within our society. And so that exemption exists. So, you know, some of that business anxiety, I think, is addressed by some of the measures that we have in place. I think lastly, I would say to Mr. Rowley that the government is obviously considering the issues that are raised by the change in policy approach adopted by the United Kingdom government. But the issues that I raised at the very beginning of my answer are the issues that we will be considering carefully in that process. And I don't know if Professor Leach may want to add a clinical perspective to the answer that I've given.
Thanks, Deputy First Minister. You've covered it very well, actually. This is all about risk and moment in the pandemic, and the decision makers have to choose at some level on that clinical advice where they draw that particular line. Let's remember what was announced in England yesterday. It wasn't a blanket 7 days for everybody. You have to be fully vaccinated. You have to take a test on day six, and 24 hours later on day seven, they have to both be negative, and you have to be symptom free. So that actually isn't a blanket release on day seven. It's quite a limited release on day seven. It does make a difference, though, to other harms, economic and social harms, because it is allowing some people to go home for Christmas who weren't expecting to do so. We are looking at it very, very carefully. We spoke to the Health Secretary yesterday about it, and we will give the advice we think is based on the science, and then Mr. Yusuf and Mr. Swinney and others will make that final decision.
Thank you. I mean, I think we will come back to this question, but it would be useful if there are exemptions in place, some kind of detail of how that actually works. I think I see a press release for Jackie Bailey last night making the point that it's about the pressure, particularly on our key frontline services, health and social care. So any updates on that would be appreciated. Can I turn quickly? I've got a couple other points. The First Minister, in her announcement, she was asked a question by Jackie Dunbar, and I'm sure it's a question certainly one that I had the last time a lot, was in terms of supporting employees who believe that they should be working from home, were working from home the last time, and encouraging employers to do so. And the First Minister, in her answer, she obviously said trade unions, but for people who are members of trade unions, but she also highlighted the Scottish Hazards, who I would say have been excellent throughout, and it's certainly I've sent quite a number of referrals their way where people have been looking for advice and support. So just quickly, can I ask, could the Deputy First Minister make sure that organisations such as Scottish Hazards are continuing to be funded and are getting funding to be able to meet the increase in demand that's been placed on them?
I certainly welcome the contribution that Scottish Hazards and other organisations have made to this process, and obviously the contribution of trade unions. As Mr Rowley will know, the government has placed an obligation on business to take account of the requirements that we are making in relation to to observing guidance that the government is publishing, and the guidance from government could not be clearer that where individuals can be working from home, they should be working from home. That is part of reducing the social interaction that is taking place within our society. And if we reduce that social interaction, for which I think there is reasonable evidence that that is happening, and that we will contribute towards breaking the chains of transmission that are involved. So I'm not familiar with any issues about the funding of Scottish Hazards, but I will look at that because they do make an important contribution. I think just lastly, convener, if I could perhaps go back to the previous answer to Mr Rowley, if it would help, I'd be happy to write to the committee about the details of the exemption process that is in place. There are some wider exemptions from the self-isolation obligations that can be pursued, although they are not, as Professor Leach said in his response to Mr Rowley, they're not exemptions without obligations. There are quite onerous requirements that individuals have to go through. But there are exemptions, and ultimately organisations can make representations to ministers, and I personally have approved a number of exemptions for individual companies who without those exemptions would not be able to provide critical services within the community, and ministers are responding to those requests that have been made by companies and responding and turning those around very swiftly.
Can I bring in Jason?
I will write to the committee on that point.
Thank you, sir. Can I bring in Professor Jason Leach?
It was only really briefly to add to that point, actually, from Mr Rowley's question. I haven't seen Ms Bailey's press release, Mr Rowley, but just to confirm, there is a blanket test and release system for all health and social care workers, not without risk and not without obligation, but health and social care workers, if they are in a household with a positive case, can be released on a negative PCR test, and then there are further obligations about caution and about everything else they have to do, as well as the critical national infrastructure system, which the Deputy First Minister has just outlined. He'll write to the committee about.
I will bring you back in, Mr Rowley, but can I just ask, it would be helpful if we could have clarification on the self-isolation before we finalise the bill report. Would this be available to the committee before the 13th of January?
In relation to the question of any change to the self-isolation position?
Yes.
We will endeavour to do that, convener. I can't give a commitment that that will be the case, but you know, having heard you, obviously that will be reflected on within government. And if there is clarity that can be offered, we will offer it within that time scheme.
Great, thank you. Can I bring Alex Rowley back in, please?
That would be useful, that information, and also I'm grateful to Mr Swinney for agreeing to check the Scottish Hazards funding. Could I turn to my third final points, which is around vaccination? I mean, there's a couple of points I want to make here. Firstly, that we have seen, I think, in one European country, others talking about a compulsory vaccination. I'm certain none of us on this call would advocate that. But do we need to be doing more? Because the evidence we took a few weeks ago, so say, for example, there was representatives of the Polish community that were making the point that back in Poland there is a reluctance to take up vaccination. Indeed, I think they're one of the countries that are looking at compulsory vaccination. But do we need to focus, and has the government got any plans to focus more specifically on those communities, those areas that have a much lower take-up. So, for example, one suggestion was that the government work with these communities and actually include people from those communities in the vaccination teams. So if you could say something about that. And the other point I was going to ask you was, you know, up until this latest variant came along, we thought we were doing really good. We thought we were making brilliant progress, and it was all about looking to recovery. So we've seen how quickly a new variant, this virus, can completely throw us off kilter and set us back and do real damage. So the question that people have continually said over the last year, when nobody's safe to everyone's safe, what kind of influence does the Scottish Government have, and what kind of influence could the Scottish Government bring to bear to get that vaccine rollout happening, to encourage the UK government, to encourage governments all over the world? Because what's clear is we could do everything that we're doing now, the sacrifices that everybody's making. This a new variant can emerge in some country where there is no vaccination, and we're back to square one. So it's absolutely in our interest, but I'm not sure, as a devolved administration, how much influence do we actually have?
Two very important questions here from Mr. Rowley. The first one, the hesitancy that there is within individual communities. A great deal of work has been done trying to tailor communication into those communities with trusted voices speaking about the vaccination programme in those communities. Mr. Rowley raises the Polish community. We are very grateful to members of the representatives of the Catholic Church who have been very active in promoting the message around vaccination, about the importance of vaccination. That message has been relayed strongly and powerfully by the Catholic community in Scotland to each members of the Polish community. I would be absolutely staggered if there weren't members of the Polish community active involved in the vaccination programme, because the members of the Polish community are very valued and significant members of the community I represent, and are very much involved in the delivery of public services in our communities. Various other steps have been taken within the Black and minority ethnic communities to increase take-up, with, again, trusted voices being involved in that communication. But having said all of that, I have to accept that we must continue to do more to reach those levels of trust and confidence that will enable people to take up the vaccination. Because to go back to where the convener started today with the constituency example that she raised from her constituent Angela, the consequences of not so doing for individuals can be, you know, very, very acute and very dangerous. So I think the government will constantly revisit the importance of ensuring we get those messages correct to those communities, and we're very grateful to trusted voices within those communities who have worked with us on that messaging. And I give the committee the assurance that we will continue to do that. On the second point that Mr. Rowley raises, and again, it's a very important question, and fundamentally he is correct. We live in a global society. The travel patterns of the world are such. And I can remember when Omicron first reared its head. It reared its head in a province in South Africa. It didn't take long before a case emerged in Hong Kong, and then cases emerged in Scotland and in the rest of the United Kingdom. And that's the world we live in nowadays. 100 years ago, a major excursion for people in Cooper Angus, near where I live, would be to go to Blairgowrie, which is a grand total of 5 miles away. Well, the world has changed immeasurably since then. And as a consequence, the ability of virus to spread is colossal unless we get comprehensive vaccination solution in place that provides much greater protection for all of us. So the Scottish Government has made these representations to the United Kingdom Government, and we will continue to do so that the UK plays an important and influential role in the international discussions about vaccine equity, and also makes a contribution to that process as well, because Mr. O'Leary is fundamentally correct. We can have as effective a booster programme as we like, but we still remain vulnerable to the development of a new variant, which could undermine the very strong efforts that we're making to keep our population safe.
Thank you. Can I move on to John Mason, please?
Thank you very much, convener. If I could start in maybe the realm of sport, and I was on Twitter last night, which may or may not be a good idea. However, there were some useful points came up, and one was around this question of why the actual number of 500 outside events and 200 at inside events has been chosen, and why it's such a blanket. And in particular, I mean, for the larger clubs, Rangers, Celtic, Aberdeen, Hibs, Hearts, 500 or 1,000 doesn't really matter too much. Effectively, it's nothing. But for some of the smaller clubs, like, say, Clyde and Airdrie, 500 to 1,000 is a big jump and would either mean they could have their whole crowd in or it's going to have to be very limited. And, I mean, the fact, for those that know their football stadiums, I mean, Airdrie and Clyde have quite modern spread out stadiums where you could easily get 1,000 people in. Albion Rovers can hardly get 500 in. So I suppose the question is why this exact number of 500, why it's not varied between different sizes of stadia, and also the 200 for inside.
I think that the key point here is that we've got to take decisions based on making sure such judgments are effective. So we, if for example, we have a multiple range of options about outside venues. So let's, for example, take the model that Mr. Mason has put to me of a variation reflecting stadium size and stadium facility. Then I think we lose clarity of message, which is a rather blunt one, and I make no apology for it being so blunt, that we need to quite simply reduce the degree to which people are interacting. And a total of 500 as a maximum for outdoor events sends a very clear signal to people in the country that we have to reduce that interaction. So, you know, for example, crowd of 500 at a Rangers game compared to a crowd of 50,000, which would normally be of that order, makes a very, very clear, significant point that we have to reduce dramatically the level of social interaction if we want to interrupt the circulation of Omicron. So there is a simple clarity that is necessary in that respect. The second point is that we have to make, I think, in judgments that will be effective in actually practically stopping or reducing the circulation of the virus. And that's about recognising that there will be limitations on the degree to which venues can accommodate individuals because of the necessity to make sure we have practical arrangements in place to stop the circulation of the virus. So it's for the reasoning for it. As for the specific numbers, well, there is no perfect science here, other than the fact that I would come back to my first point, which is we've got to take clear and understandable decisions which are set within the policy choices that we make, which are about reducing the social interaction between individuals.
Okay, I mean, if I can just maybe follow up slightly on that. I mean, previously we had no crowds at all at sports events, including footballs. So I'm not arguing for that, but I just wonder why, you know, why not just, by that logic, not stop crowds altogether?
Well, I suppose that would be an option, but the government is trying here to, as pragmatic as we possibly can be, about the implications of our decisions. Nobody wants to take these decisions. I don't take any pleasure whatsoever in these decisions. But we're trying to strike a balance that enables people to some extent, be able to continue to enjoy particular events, albeit with very limited crowds in attendance, and but at the same time, to take the effective action that is necessary to suppress the circulation of the virus. And that's the balanced judgment the government is trying to arrive at.
Okay, thanks for that. I accept that. And still kind of on the sports theme, on the question of compensation, now Murdo Fraser did press you and you were clear that decisions will be made fairly soon and we'll get an announcement. But I mean, I just wonder if you could maybe say that you would not rule out support for, say, a sports organisation in my constituency like Glasgow Rocks Basketball. I have to say I personally had bought tickets for next Wednesday, and they're now not going to have any crowds, if whatsoever. And that puts them in a particularly difficult position because they're competing with English teams which are allowed large crowds. So likes of them, likes of the carnival at Glasgow, likes of taxi drivers, who are all losing out, in some cases linked to events, are they at least in the running for getting some kind of compensation?
I think it's probably best that I appreciate the committee's desire for clarity on this point, but I think it's probably best if I simply say I don't actually think I've got much I can add to what I said to Mr. Fraser earlier on. The government is considering a range of options. The Finance Secretary is giving that her attention just now. I think it would be inappropriate of me to start defining what should and should not be the areas that are looked at beyond the decisions that have been announced already. But I hear the points that Mr. Mason is making, and I know the Finance Secretary will be receiving representations from a very broad range of sectors which have been affected. I think I have to also reiterate my point that I made to Mr. Fraser, that it is going to be impossible for us to support every sector that is affected by these latest changes. That is why we have asked the United Kingdom government to engage substantively in putting in place a set of measures that would be sufficient to support those sectors, and I would reiterate that call today.
Okay, thanks very much. To move on to a different area, the question of drugs for actually treating COVID, I think I saw some coverage in the media that the UK is buying, I think it's two different kinds of drugs, I certainly don't know what they are. And I just wonder where we are with that. I mean, are these kind of drugs and treatments still being developed? And you know, some people say to me, well, why bother getting the vaccine if we can get a drug later on? And I mean, I tend to say, well, prevention is better than cure, but that's perhaps a slightly simplistic answer. So I just wonder if you can give us any update, and maybe this is Professor Leach, as to where we are with drugs and treatment. And just attached to that, I had somebody, a friend with long COVID, who said that when they got their JAG, they improved, they felt. Now, that's just anecdotal, but I just wonder if there's any evidence for that. Thanks.
I will bring Professor Leach in on some of the detail of this question, but I would encourage Mr. Mason to continue with the prevention as opposed to cure advice. I think that's absolutely solid advice. Prevention by getting the vaccination is much better than hoping that you can be rescued by a cure. So we know that the vaccination is very effective at reducing the severity of the virus. That has been true up until now with Delta. The booster is crucial in that process in relation to Omicron, and where some of the earlier vaccines are not as robust as they have been. So prevention is absolutely central to the advice that we should be issuing. So Mr. Mason is absolutely correct to maintain that position. Now, in relation to the drugs that are available, there are two drug treatments that are available. If my memory serves me right, one of them is in of test pilot condition. Professor Leach will give us the proper terminology for that. And I think it's important for me to stress at this stage, and this comes again back to the prevention versus cure point. Prevention is available to a very large proportion of our population. All over 18s are have access to the to varying degrees. All over 12s have got access to a vaccination program as we speak. A drug will be available in the short term to a very, 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 very small proportion of the population, and particularly if it's in a pilot exercise. So I wouldn't have people holding out hope at an early stage for a drug intervention. Taking part in the vaccination programme is a much more effective intervention for individuals to make. But I invite Professor Leach to add to my comments.
Thank you. This is good news, Mr. Mason, but let's put it in perspective. It's becoming increasingly apparent as time passes that your principal risk in serious outcomes from COVID is to do with your immunity. Either your baseline immunity, because you've had a transplant or you have some other immunosuppression disease, or you're unvaccinated. That is the principal risk factor, or you're very elderly, where your immune system is beginning to fail. So that fits. Actually, we're discovering that a lot of the risk factors that we thought early on might cause more severe disease are actually proving not to be that big a deal. So it's age and immunity, and the combination of those two things are the people who are suffering. Therefore, if, for instance, vaccination doesn't protect you as much if you're 94 or if you've had a heart transplant, then these drugs are really, really useful. And they've been developed at breakneck speed. They're safe. They're good. We have procured them on a UK basis. It's been excellent cooperation across the four UK countries, and we will use them for those that need them. But Mr. Swinney is absolutely right. It is on the periphery of the population's response to this COVID-19 pandemic. And the population response remains vaccination, home testing, and following the guidance. But if you end up in hospital, then particularly if you're immunocompromised, these antivirals will absolutely be part of your treatment going forward. And more will come. Drug companies all over the world are working on this because it's crucial. Antivirals traditionally have not been very good, frankly, unlike antibiotics, which have revolutionized medicine in the last 100 years. Antivirals are very, very difficult to make and to make work. So these are considerably better. We're encouraged by early results, but they are for a particular portion of the sick who progress from medium disease to serious disease and death. And that's principally the immunocompromised.
Okay, thanks. And if I may just have one final, hopefully brief question. I mean, again, there's been media coverage. I think that the number of lateral flow tests being used is increasing, and that sounds like good news. But there was also coverage that people using check-in apps, test and protect and so on, is decreasing. And I've noticed that actually in Parliament, because people are meant to check in for the coffee bar, and I don't think so many are. So is the check-in side of things still important?
It's absolutely vital, Convener, and we reiterated that point in the First Minister's statement on Tuesday. We've reiterated that in the obligations that we are placing on businesses and venues to make sure that the check-in arrangements are visible and complied with, and that businesses are operating, you know, having taken account of the, you know, the wording is to have regard to make sure that that is undertaken. So yes, the whole check-in arrangement is absolutely crucial to enable us to interrupt the transmission of the virus. I think it's encouraging news that more lateral flow tests have been used. I think people are, it is such a straightforward process, and it's so crucial in giving people, I know of numerous cases where people have frankly stumbled across the fact that they are COVID positive, by doing regular lateral flow tests, had absolutely no symptoms whatsoever, and got a positive test, and they've been able to change their behaviour and actions as a consequence of undertaking that lateral flow test. And that, I think, is a really significant strengthening of our ability to resist the challenges that we face.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. Can I bring in Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and colleagues. I'm always struck in this is a committee's called the COVID Recovery Committee, and seems to me that week on week we struggle to get to that particular idea of a recovery as events overtake us. But so I suppose I'm going to try again and sort of look ahead and actually ask the question about what does recovery actually look like? Are we because we seem to be on a loop here of, you know, if we go right to the very start of this, we were in isolation, then along came vaccination, and then along comes the booster, and we're back into restrictions again. Are we now considering that this is a cycle that might be indefinite? Because I remember asking Professor Leach a couple of months ago when he thought, you know, we would get back to some kind of normality, and back then, this is no criticism, I may say, back then the thought was, from Professor Leach, it would be the spring for the United Kingdom and up to 5 years for the world, and we now know that's not the case. So I think my question is really is what does recovery from this virus look like, and are we just going to have to get to a point where we're living with it indefinitely? I can ask Professor Leach if I could.
It's a great question, Mr. Whittle, and the WHO have given a series of press conferences this week where their tone has changed, actually in response to a previous question from the committee about global vaccination and global response. It has never been one bound and you're free, not to be flippant, but it was never going to be that. But pandemics last a long time, traditionally. Now, this is a unique pandemic, as they all are, because it comes at a moment in time, as Mr. Swinney's already described, where travel is more available, but also global science is more available. So there are differences between this one and the 1918 one around the availability of vaccination, the availability of drugs, etc., etc. I still have hope that spring will look very different to winter across the UK and Western Europe. And depending on what happens to the virus, which is the key unknown, we will then go into 2022, perhaps in a more open way. If I take you back 4 weeks, Scotland was open. Everything was open. We were still wearing face coverings. We were still testing and we were vaccinating. But everything was open and society was returning. I had been for dinner more than I'd been for dinner in the previous 2 years. I had theatre booked, I had et cetera, as did many in the country. What's happened is the fourth globally transmissible variant has won the race again, and it's now in half of the world's countries almost. What will happen next is crucial. The Omicron is not the end. There will be more. It will depend if, as we've touched on this morning, if Omicron is a little bit less severe, will Sigma, Mu, whatever they decide to call the next one, be less severe again. Now, if that continues to happen, and the optimistic virologists think it might, then 2022 looks very different to 2021. But that is a global problem, not a Scottish problem. And we have to bear in mind, as the WHO said yesterday, you cannot boost your way out of a global pandemic. You have to vaccinate the world, and you have to continue protections around the world until you manage to do that. And then the virus does its thing and we manage depending on what we get.
If I could add to that, Professor Leach has given the clinical and epidemiological underpinning of this, but let me give the policy perspective as well, because Mr. Whittle is absolutely correct in having the aspiration to be able to secure a recovery from COVID. That's why the government proceeded to formulate, after consultation in the summer, the COVID recovery strategy, which was published on the 5th of October. It is the subject of implementation. So despite the challenges we face with Omicron, various steps since the 5th of October have been taken to implement the COVID recovery strategy, focused, as colleagues will know, on ensuring that we tackle the inequalities that became more severe during, that existed before COVID, that became more severe during COVID, and principally to focus on eradicating child poverty. Now, the Joint Programme Board that is leading the implementation of the recovery strategy, which is jointly chaired by the President of the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities and by me, has now met. It has formulated its approach in terms of developing and delivering the programme, and that will now become an ongoing theme. So, notwithstanding the fact that we've had this sort of three-week aberration where we've had to focus on Omicron, and we obviously have restrictions that are coming, that are going to be with us for a few weeks to come, I would assure Mr. Whittle that there is ongoing sustained activity underway to implement the COVID recovery strategy while we continue to deal with a pandemic that has a different character, because Professor Leach is absolutely right. Just a few weeks ago, Scotland was open. We were wearing face coverings, we were watching what we were doing, and there's nothing wrong with that. Good set of measures to have in place, but there's also steps been taken to implement the COVID recovery strategy.
Thank you very much. That's really helpful. I think, given that I'm a cup half full kind of guy, and obviously I'm very much hopeful that as we go forward through the next few months, we get to a much better place. But as both of you highlighted, this variant is of a different character, and there's nothing to guarantee that that won't happen again in the future. So there's a couple of things pop out of that, a couple of questions pop out of that. I'll ask the first one, and it is around finance. I know there's been debate around finance, Mr. Swinney, and I don't want to get into that, but my concern here is if we continue on this sort of cycle, if you like, it's an inevitability that finance is going to become more and more and more restricted, which will then give us less and less options of how we respond to another variant or another as we go on. So how are we modelling that? How is the Scottish Government and working with others to model globally how we're going to deal with that?
This gets to the nub of the challenges that exist around about the public finances. And Mr. Putnam will appreciate that, I'm not being partisan in the comments that I'm making here. It's just a simple reflection of reality. If the Scottish Government wants to allocate money to compensate businesses for the implications of COVID restrictions, we have to take that money from somewhere else that it's currently allocated to in the Scottish budget. We have to shift that money around, and we've taken a decision that will shift around £200 million into the purposes of supporting the restrictions funding that we've got for the forthcoming period. That will be uncomfortable, believe you me, it's uncomfortable for us to wrestle with that. The UK, and we do that because we're in a fixed budget environment now. The UK government is able to borrow. It can borrow in the money markets, it can expand the money it's got available, and it can redeploy that. Which is why we say to the UK government, look, in an endeavour to meet the challenges of today, let's allocate money that we can pay back over a period of a number of years. And the UK government's responded with £1 billion of funding. It's not responded with a scale that I think would be commensurate with the challenges that we face. But we do have to take decisions in the short term to try to support individuals and organisations when they face these challenges, and that's what the Scottish Government has opted to do within our fixed budget, and what I would urge the United Kingdom Government to do in the flexibilities they have available to them.
Yeah, I think, Mr. Swinney, I appreciate what you're saying there, but I'm more concerned as this goes on in a global financial market, the squeeze on global finances is going to almost if, for example, another Omicron comes along, it's going to squeeze us to a point where how we respond to, how the globally respond to this, are going to be limited. That's really where I was getting at, Mr.
Well, you see, I think where that takes you back to is the questions that Mr. Rowley put to me earlier on in the session, that this is a global pandemic. The solution, we can do a lot here. Yes, of course we can, and we will do that. But frankly, the solutions lie across the globe, that we've got to have global resilience. If we want to have an interconnected world as we have, if we want to be able to really move people and goods around the world and for individuals to be able to do that, then there has to be global resilience to enable that to be the case. And therefore, the type of programmes that Mr. Rowley was talking about global vaccination programmes, are important to provide that resilience so that we can have some ability to be confident that the obstacles we have in our way are sufficiently robust to protect us from a variant that can emerge from a jurisdiction on the other side of the planet, and it can be with us in a matter of days. And that's what's happened here. A variant that's emerged in one part of the world is just spread like wildfire.
Thank you. And the second part of the question I was going to ask around if the current cycle is in any way continues, I think we all understand weariness of dealing with this pandemic. And I think the behavioural response to restrictions has already been one of my colleagues already talked about the check-in apps for track and trace. There's reports out there's less of that happening. There was also, I don't know if you're aware, reports of fans chanting at a football match about refusing boosters ahead of the event restrictions. I think the concern here is this sort of disaffection, especially among the young, and not complying. Is there a recognition of that, and how do we combat that and ensure that sort of there is a high level of compliance continued and maintained as we get more weary with this?
I think there's a mixed picture on this. I recognise the point that John Mason put to me earlier on about some of the check-in procedures may not be followed as assiduously. I hear and I see some anecdotal evidence about people not wearing face coverings where they should be doing so. In fact, I spend absolutely none of my time in the retail environment, to be honest. I don't really get near the shops very often, but I hear anecdotal reports about face coverings and the challenges that staff face about ensuring these are applied. Having said that, I think generally, since the Scottish Government, First Minister, said to people a week past Tuesday, I need you to reduce your social interaction because of Omicron, I think people have generally done that. I think there's pretty tangible evidence of that being the case. It's manifest itself as quite a significant implication for the hospitality sector, because lots of people have said, look, we can't go out for that Christmas lunch we thought we'd be going out for, or we can't go out to that event. And people have taken those decisions. It's had implications for others and for business sectors. I acknowledge that. But I think people have taken it forward. So, and also, I think the evidence about lateral flow test uptake and utilisation is very, very encouraging. So I think in amongst all of this, it is a mixed picture, but I think we should be optimistic that members of the public recognise the seriousness of the situation we face and are responding accordingly.
Thank you. That's me finished, convener.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. Jim Fairley, would you like to come in?
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to Mr. Swinney and his team. Like Mr. Whittle, I am always considering the COVID recovery element of our committee, and I do hope that my glass is half full as well. But I do want to kind of look at some of the financial implications of where we are right now. Mr. Swinney, I wonder if it would be possible for you to give us a kind of a breakdown of how we have got to the $375 million in total, because it's, I quite often see on social media and in conversations, there's figures get bounced about all over the place, and oh yeah, but that didn't matter because that was, but, oh yeah, but then that money came in. So could you give us a kind of a brief outline of how we have gotten to a £375 million total fund?
I can't, you know, essentially, the United Kingdom government has made three announcements on in the recent period on COVID funding. The first was to confirm that the Scottish Government would be receiving £220 million in consequential funding from the UK government. Now that wasn't a new allocation, that was a confirmation of allocations that we expected. Now it wasn't complete because we had expected to receive £265 million. So we got £220 million confirmed out of an expectation of 265, which left us £45 million short. Last weekend, it must be last weekend, the UK government confirmed it was adding £220 million to that. So when you take off the 45 that we, sorry, yeah, 45, you end up with £175 million of what I would call unanticipated funding to the Scottish government for COVID purposes. So we have allocated that to the fund that I've talked about. And then the Scottish Government, in two individual tranches, has identified from within our own resources two blocks of £100 million that we are allocating to business support, and we are also allocating £100 million to boost the funding available for a self-isolation support grant because of the demand for that grant. So in terms of business support, there is £375 million available. £200 million of it has come from within the fixed budget of the Scottish Government, £175 million from the United Kingdom Government, and we have £100 million extra added to the social, the self-isolation support grant.
Okay, thank you very much. I have had cause over the last 2 weeks to be in two cities, driving through these cities, particularly in the west end of Glasgow, and the number of hospitality businesses is stark if you start to look for it. My guess is the £375 million in total is a drop in the ocean of what would be needed in order to give any kind of compensation to these multitude of businesses right across the country who are in their prime money-taking season. How much does the Scottish Government know it would actually take to properly keep these businesses supported over the next 3 weeks and stop any of them from going to the wall?
Well, that's a very difficult question to answer because there are a huge number of variables in answering that question. The first of which is the question of sustainability and survivability, because the purpose of our interventions so far have been to essentially help businesses to get through to the other side of COVID. So at the various stages of the pandemic, there have been periods where businesses have been closed, or they have been restricted, or they have been able to fully trade. And in the process of those different periods, different financial support has been in place, to the extent that when businesses have been able to fully operate, no financial support has been available because they have been able to trade the marketplace as we would expect. So that's the question of survivability will vary from business to business depending on their trading environment. The second point is about some businesses will still be able to operate to some extent during this period and have been able to do so over recent weeks, albeit they may not have been able to realise the revenues that they might have hoped for in this period. And there's a difference between what one might have hoped for and what one needs to get to the other side of this particular period. So for these reasons, it's difficult for the government to come to a definitive conclusion on that estimate. What I would assure Mr. Fairley about is that the Scottish Government has gone through an exercise of looking in a very challenging way at what is the amount of money we can make available to help people in this context. And that exercise has involved us looking at the remaining public expenditure between now and the end of the financial year. And as members of the committee will be familiar, a large proportion of the government's expenditure, once set in a budget, is very, very firmly committed. We have a health service to run, which accounts for is the largest single element of the Scottish Government's budget, of the order of 40% of the budget. So, you know, we have got a large part of the budget locked into the running of the health service. A large part of the budget is locked into the running of other public services in relation to schools, care facilities, and a variety of other items. So the degree of manoeuvrability and flexibility that exists within a fixed budget is very, very limited. Therefore, £200 million for business support and £100 million for self-isolation support, the government has found, it, you know, will cause us discomfort. And that's what the Finance Secretary has looked at and is managing at the present moment.
Well, segued perfectly into my next question. And having run a business, I always want to know what's coming down the line. And you may not be in a position to answer this question right now. The Scottish Government have found £200 million from a fixed budget. Who's going to lose out?
Well, that's about us managing the public finances to ensure that we minimise negative outcomes on individuals. So we'll have to look at the timing. We're looking at the timing of programmes, the times at which we authorise and approve financial commitments to give us as much flexibility. So every single bit of flexibility that we have, there are always underspends in a financial year. There must be in a fixed budget. There have to be underspends, or you run the risk of breaching your budget ceiling. And the Scottish Government has never breached its budget ceiling. 16 years of unqualified opinions from the Auditor General are a demonstration of our financial competence. So you have to run underspend if you want to deliver an unqualified audit opinion. So there will be underspends, and we have to make sure those underspends happen to deal with the expenditure that we're facing.
Well, it's safe to conclude there's going to be some difficult decisions further down the line.
There are.
Can I just go on? I'm going to change subjects now slightly. Last week I mentioned the fact that my father had gone into hospital with COVID, and I can very happily say he's now out of hospital, but he's still considerably debilitated with delirium. Now, my dad had a double jag. He had a heart issue. He had a double jag, and he missed his booster. And when he was in hospital, he was given the viral drug, which was effectively told that that would save his life. It has done, but it hasn't left him without problems. And I'm making that point in the committee just to highlight the points that you made earlier on, or that were made earlier on in the session, about getting the message out about individual circumstances. So it was mentioned last week in the BBC about my father not being able to get a care package. We've now managed to get him out through other means, and he is making a recovery. But that's 7 weeks where, A, we didn't know if he was going to live, and B, he's now left with issues that we're still going to have to work through. So I think that's a point that needs to be made. If I have time for one more question, Convener?
Just a quick one.
Okay. Message confusion is slightly concerning me. If we've got home working, as Alec Riley talked about, should it be a legal requirement, and should there be consequences for employers who are not allowing people to work from home?
First of all, Convener, can I say that I'm pleased to hear that Mr. Fairley Sr. is making the recovery. Fairley is a man for whom I have the greatest of respect and regard, and have for and known him for a very large part of my life, so I wish him well and I'm glad to hear he's home. In relation to Mr. Fairley's second point, the ability to exercise those powers would strike me as being, I'd have to consider it carefully, but they would strike me as being out with the competence of the Scottish Government, would be my initial reaction, because it would be us essentially intervening in areas of policy around corporate activities over which we do not have competence. But that's my first initial reaction. What the Scottish Government has, however, done is given the clearest possible signals, encouragement and motivation to businesses to enable staff to work from home. And that's for two reasons. Firstly, the more that people work from home, the more we reduce social interaction and reduce the ability for the virus to spread. And secondly, it enables us to ensure the continued operation of business models, albeit in a different format, which sustains the ongoing performance of the Scottish economy. So what we've tried to do is to maintain a working environment as much as possible, albeit in a different fashion to how many of us have worked in the past, but to enable us to sustain economic activity within our society, but to do that as effectively and sustainably as we possibly can.
I'm going to bring in Alex Rowley now.
I think it's probably for Professor Leach, but the booster gives us the protection that we need, and that's been shown. But I couldn't help but note that Israel have now introduced a fourth jab, so a second booster, I think. Is that something that is permanently under review? And what progress has been made in considering if and when more vulnerable people may need another booster, but also going into to the new year, will we need more vaccinations next year?
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Riley. Israel have authorised a fourth dose, not implemented clinically a fourth dose, and the authorisation has been for the vulnerable, the elderly and those who are immunosuppressed. They haven't actually pressed the button on it yet. It's a timing thing. Israel was first. Israel did all the Pfizer trials, so therefore they are ahead of the rest of the world, just before Chile and just before the United Kingdom in terms of sequencing of who got vaccine first. We absolutely keep that under review, the WHO on behalf of the world, the UK on behalf of all of us, to see what will be required. It's difficult to predict entirely because it looks as though the immunity dimmer switch gets turned up quite well by the booster dose. Some people, of course, the immunosuppressed, got three primary doses and then a booster. So we do have some people on their fourth dose inside Scotland. That dimmer switch has to stay up. And as soon as it begins to fade, we will know from trials. And then the Joint Committee will make decisions and give advice about what to do next. I wouldn't at all be surprised if into next year, spring, summer, we'd be vaccinating the vulnerable again. I simply don't know if we'll need to vaccinate the whole population again as quickly as that. It may be a little bit later. Most of the smart money is probably on do the vulnerable first and then do the rest of the population again. And then that might be an annual occurrence or even quicker than that. And the Joint Committee will decide that based on the trials.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Leach. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. I now move on to the third agenda item, which is consideration of the motion on the MAID affirmative instrument considered during the previous agenda item. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSI before we take the motion?
Convener, if I could just say a few words about the order for the record. Following the Four Nations Basis Review of the International Travel Regulations, the Public Health No. 13 instrument removed the temporary addition of the 11 countries on the red list from 4 a.m. on the Wednesday, the 15th of December, as the rapid growth of Omicron across the world meant it was appropriate to do so at this point. Technical amendments were also made to provide for children travelling to Scotland who are aged 11 and under to allow them to leave self-isolation if their accompanying adults' day 2 test comes back negative. This does not change the position of where the adult's test is positive. Children here must remain in isolation. Where one adult in the travelling group or family is positive and another is negative, the domestic isolation guidance would apply, and household contacts of any person who tests positive are asked to isolate for 10 days. If a child under the age of 11 is arriving unaccompanied, they are no longer required to self-isolate. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I now invite you to move S6M-02630.
I move that formally, Convener.
Thank you. Does any member wish to speak on the motion before I put the question forward? And if you could put an R in the chat function, please. I note that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so I will now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M-02630 be agreed to. Do all members agree? If you do not agree, please put it in the chat function. Okay, thank you. The motion is agreed. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instrument considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item and our time with the Deputy First Minister. And I would like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his supporting officials for their attendance this morning. Can I wish everyone a very Merry Christmas, keep safe and look out for each other. That concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and I suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave and to move the meeting into the private session.